Hello and welcome everyone to this XRM Vision webinar, where our host Eliza Benitez, I hope I pronounced it properly.
Yes, that's right.
She's an expert in the AI builder, besides many other things, in the AI builder part of the Power Platform. And she's an MVP out of New Zealand. And this morning for her, she's going to be presenting the automation toolkit, document automation toolkit. And Eliza, the floor is yours.
Cool. Thanks, Eric. So I'm going to start off by saying bonjour, Quebec. Je m'appelle Eliza Benitez. Hello to the rest of the world. My name is Eliza Benitez. And as Eric said, today I have the pleasure of sharing with you all the Power Platform Document Automation Toolkit. So before we get started, I'll just talk a little bit about myself. So I am in New Zealand. I live in the capital city of Wellington. I've been a consultant for over 10 years. I started with Dynamics CRM4 back in 2009. So now it's called Dynamics 365. And then my journey with the Power Platform started in 2018. So it was all because of Shane Young. So Shane Young has this EDX course, which goes through Power Apps, Power Automate, and SharePoint. And through that course, I fell in love with Power Automate. So it's all because of him. And yeah, in my spare time, I go for bike rides. I love to cook. And I also have a series on my YouTube channel called WTF, What the Flow. So it's where I share and basically do videos on how you can use Cloud Flows and Power Automate. Okay, so for the agenda today, I'm going to explain what is the Power Platform Document Automation Toolkit. So it was something that was released early this year in February, I believe. And then I'm going to talk about the user story so that all of you can understand and relate to what I'm going to be showing you today. I'm also going to cover the prerequisites that come with the Document Automation Toolkit, just so that you're aware that there are some things that you do need to have in place before you go ahead and try out the Document Automation Toolkit. Then I'm going to talk about the components in the solution, which are the Dataverse tables, the Power Automate Cloud Flows, the Document Automation Canvas app, and then I'm going to show you how to install it, set it up, and do the configuration. Then I'll show you all of it in action, and it's pretty cool. And then I'm going to talk about ideas to extend the automation that comes with the toolkit. And then I'm going to share some additional materials before we have our Q&A. All right. So with that being said, this is essentially what the Document Automation Toolkit is. So if you have a look on the screen, you can see that there's a couple of areas. You've got someone or a group of people who are sending through some forms that are either going to be in the form of a PDF or a document, and you tend to receive them through an email. And then basically when it hits that inbox in your Outlook, it's going to trigger the automation. And that automation is essentially what's going to handle every single piece to get that data extracted from the forms that are uploaded into Dataverse. So Dataverse is essentially going to be the hub of where the mapping is, as well as the data and the files. And then it's also going to utilize AI Builder. So AI Builder form processing to be exact. And then it's going to display the information from Dataverse into a Canvas app so that a manual reviewer can review the document that's been extracted, the data that's been extracted from the document before they can pretty much say that it's accurate. So this Document Automation Toolkit is essentially a way for you as a company to understand how you can do document automation yourself. And it's a starting point so that you could start thinking about the different processes in your organization that you could essentially automate if you handle a lot of forms. Sorry, I did not update that, my bad. So in terms of the user story, this is the Revenue Quebec form. So this is a form that is used to capture the details of the net income of a self-employed person. So in terms of the user story, it's as a tax advisor, when an email is received And the attachment is the Revenue Quebec self-employed net income form. I want the data to be automatically extracted so that I don't have to enter it into our system. And I also need the ability to review the data extracted so that I can correct the data where relevant. So in other circumstances, if you weren't using this toolkit, you would have the data automatically extracted and stored into somewhere like Dataverse, and then you would then lift that data and push it out somewhere into, let's say, your payroll system or something like Workday. But with a toolkit, it gives you the opportunity to review that data to validate it before it actually can be sent off to another application or system in your company. So that's what this toolkit is. It's giving you the opportunity to review that data. So in terms of the prerequisites, you do need a Dataverse environment because there are tables within the toolkit that need to be created. And those tables are important because it's all to do with the processing of the documents and storing those documents, and as well as act as the data mapping that you're going to see shortly in the AI Builder Form processing model. You also need one Power Automate license to run the flows in the toolkit. And then we have two types of users. The first one is a process owner. So a process owner is going to be a user that's going to be doing the configuration as well as set up which AI Builder model the app is going to use. And then you also have reviewers. So reviewers are the ones who are going to review the data from the document that has been uploaded into an email. And these users, they do need a Power Apps license, so keep that in mind. The environment also needs capacity in terms of AI Builder. So this is what it looks like. If you go to the AI Builder calculator webpage, and you can put the number of pages that you're going to process in a form, and then it's going to give you an estimate of what that fee will be. So just keep in mind, like, the higher the numbers are, then it means that the cost will be higher. Okay. So then in terms of learning purposes, after you watch this webinar and you want to go ahead and try it out yourself in your own company, you've got three options. The first one is you can create a trial license in your company's tenant, or you can create a trial separate to your company's tenant. Now, please keep in mind, if you do go with number one, make sure that you talk to the relevant people in your company. Don't just create a trial license without their knowledge. So I just want to put that out there. The second one is a community plan, but as I mentioned in here in the slides, there are some limitations, so just be aware of that. Okay, so in terms of the Dataverse tables, these are essentially the four tables that will come with a toolkit. So the first one, which is the document automation configuration, will store the information about the AI Builder model that is used. So you're going to see this displayed in the app when you do the configuration. So I'll be showing you that. Then there's a document automation taxonomy. So this is the one where I mentioned earlier, where it's going to grab the data mapping from the AI Builder model to the relevant columns in this particular Dataverse table that's going to store the data. Then we have the document automation processing. So this is a table that's going to represent pretty much the status of that automation. So there's different status values, so things like ready to be processed or extracting data or validating data. Then the document automation data is essentially where the values are stored from the document. So this is the table that you would look at when you need to grab that data and push it out to another application or system in your company. So then we also have three cloud flows as part of this automation. So the first one is the email importer. So this is the one that is triggered whenever a new email comes through and has a document attached to it. So it's pretty much going to grab that document, push it into Dataverse, store it in the relevant table, and then it's going to update the status to extracted data. The second cloud flow is what we call the document automation processor. So this is triggered as soon as that status is updated to extracted data. It's going to retrieve each document. It's going to run through the AI Builder form processing model to extract that required data. And then it's going to apply some logic, and it's also going to update the status to validate data. The last one is the document automation validator flow. So basically, after the document is processed, it's essentially going to update the state to ready for manual review, which is then reflected in the app for the manual reviewer. And then lastly, we have the document automation app. So this is the Canvas app. This is the app that your manual reviewer or your process owners are going to use to view the documents, review it, and then validate that document. And if you're a process owner, you will see an additional tab where you can define which AI builder form processing model the app is going to use. Okay. Oh, I've just covered this, so I'll just go ahead to the next slide, which is now to the demo. So the first thing that you need to do is create your environment if you don't have one already. So to create the environment, I've just done some pre-recordings while I was setting this up for the webinar so that I could show you. So you pretty much go to your Power Platform Admin Center, you create a new environment, you select the type of environment and where it's going to be based in terms of the region, and you do have to create a database for this Dataverse environment, because essentially that's where the tables are going to be stored. And that's pretty much it. As soon as it's finished preparing the instance, then you'll see a state of ready. Because this is a trial, this is why you see trial in the type column. If this was a live environment, it would be a sandbox environment. So then the next step is to install the solution. And to install the solution, they've made it very easy. So basically, you go to the Power Automate Maker site, and over on the left-hand side, you click on AI Builder, and then there's this option in here called Document Automation. And when you scroll down, it'll give you some solutions. So you can see that there's one that's able to be selected. And pretty much once you install the solution, so this does take some time. This is all fast forward, by the way. And then you create your connections for each of the connectors. What you're seeing right now is if you don't have a connection already, you're being prompted to create that connection. And so once you go back to the setup, you just refresh it, and then it's going to allow you to save those connections. There's also hyperlinks to some documentation, as well as the solution and the app that you do need to use. So it's designed in a way where you can install it and you're pretty much ready to go. But you do have to create your AI builder model. So that's what I'm going to show you shortly, and I'm going to do that live. All right, so this is pretty much what the solution looks like when you view it. These are all of the components that you're going to see. And I've already talked about the tables, the cloud flows, and the app in the earlier slides. So in terms of the Canvas app, number one is the Documents tab. So if you're a manual reviewer, this is what you're going to see. You're not going to see number two. Number two is the configuration side. So that's only for process owners. So if you're a process owner and you need to link this app to an AI builder model, you would see this tab. If you're a manual reviewer, this is all you're going to see. And you're going to see a list of documents, when it was received, and then the status. So whether it's currently extracting the data or whether it's ready to be reviewed. So two more things that you do need to do after you've done the install is you need to assign the security roles. So if you are a document automation reviewer, then you need a manual reviewer security role. If you're a manual reviewer, you need the document automation reviewer security role. And if you're a process owner, then you need the system customizer security role. The other thing that you need to do is share the Canvas app with the user. Please take note that this isn't currently outlined in the Microsoft Learn module, which I'll share with you at the end. They are going to update that, so just keep that in mind. You do need to share the Canvas app with the users as well as make sure that they have the appropriate Power Apps license. So in terms of those two security roles that I mentioned, we have that document automation reviewer and then the system customizer. So this is all done in the Power Platform Admin Center. You pretty much select your environment, then you select the users, and then you select the security roles for each of those users. Okay, so now we get to the fun part. So I'm going to switch over to my browser, and I'm going to show you how to create an AI builder model, and it's pretty cool in my opinion, because if you told me that this is something that we could have done, let's say 5 years ago, I wouldn't have believed you. Okay, so I'm in the Power Automate Maker site. So this is what it looks like if you've never seen this before. And on the left-hand side, we're gonna go down to AI Builder, and we are going to select Build. In here is where I can see the different AI Builder services that can be used. And the one that we're going to use today is the form processing. So these are the other models that you can use as part of AI Builder. So the one that is used by the Document Automation Toolkit is this one, form processing. So I can name this AI model. So I'll call this demo for today. And one thing that I do want to share with you is in this wizard, you'll see that they have some self-guided information. So in here, it's going to tell you right away that you need to teach the model about your document. So in other words, you need to define the fields. And then after that, you would need to upload your documents, tag the data that's in the document so that the model can be trained and you can publish it. In the examples tab, you also have the ability to download sample documents. So in here as well is where you'll get a bunch of invoices. And if I click the next arrow, it will show you different layouts of invoices. So one cool thing about the form processing in AI Builder is that you can have what we call collections. So let's say if we go with this example that you have on screen, you've got invoices that you receive on a daily basis from your suppliers. This can be one form of an invoice, and you can have another form of an invoice that looks like this. But if they all have the same information, so things like the invoice item, the quantity, the unit price, and then things like price excluding, I don't know what it is in Quebec. Is it HST?
There's HST and QST.
Yes. So you can have different collections. As long as the forms have the same data, it'll be smart enough to be able to extract them. So for example, this form would be one collection, and this layout for this form would be another collection. So it's pretty smart in being able to extract the data from different layouts of forms, as long as the information is the same across the forms. Then in terms of the best practices tab, again, the team have done a really good job in providing you with some tips on, you know, what's good and what's not good. And yeah, it's pretty much a great way to educate yourself when you're trying this out for the first time. Okay, and then the next thing that you're going to see is that you'll see a prompt that it's telling you that you need at least 5 documents with the same layout for each collection. So when I click create, what's going to happen is that behind the scenes, it's going to create this new AI builder model, and we can then go ahead and start defining our fields. So in terms of the form, if I just pull my browser across, This is the form. And so for each of the information that you need to extract, you would essentially create them as fields in your AI Builder model. And one piece of advice for me is if you are going to be doing this for a real life project within your company, I recommend that you define those fields first. So for example, in here, I've put my list of fields in something like an Excel spreadsheet. And so that way I know that I've got these list of fields that I need to create. So if I just go ahead and copy this value, and I just minimize this and go back to the AI Builder model, I have an option here to create a field, or I can create a table. If this was an invoice, then I would be selecting table, but because this is a form, I'm going to select a field, and then you can type in your field name, or you can paste it in, and you click done, and that's pretty much it. So you keep going until you have all of your fields defined. So in this list, I have 34 fields in total. So I'm not going to go through all of that. So I'm going to go through to another model that I've prepared already. So if I just go back a step, here are all the fields that I've created. So all of that is now in my AI Builder model. So then once you've defined your fields that need to exist in your model for the automatic extraction of the data. The next step is to create a new collection. And so if I name this, I can just call this the self-employed net income form. And then I simply click on the plus icon, and then in here is where you're going to be prompted to upload your documents. So as soon as I click add documents, we're going to see three options in terms of the data source. The first one is uploading from your local storage. So in other words, files on your PC or on your laptop. The second one is from SharePoint. So you have the ability to grab files from your SharePoint site as well. And then the second one is from your Azure Blob storage. So you've got different options in terms of where you can extract that data from. For today's demo, I'm just going to grab files from my local storage. So here are my forms that I've prepared in advance. So I just select them. And now it's going to upload them. And once I click this button, it's going to go through the process of uploading it into the AI builder model. So now when I click close, what's going to happen is we're going to see that these five documents have been uploaded into a collection. If I had another collection, so going back to the example that I stated earlier, if you have different invoices that you receive from suppliers and they're in different layouts, then essentially for one layout, you would create one collection, and for another layout, you would create a second collection. As long as the information is consistent against your collections, then you can go ahead and use it in a single AI Builder form processing model. So once you've got all your documents uploaded across your collections, you can then click Analyze. So what's going to happen now is that the AI Builder model is going to analyze all of those documents that you've uploaded. And then in the next step is where we're going to tag the documents. So what I mean by tag is we're essentially going to use our mouse, so this little guy, and then we're going to drag and pretty much select the information from fields. And then you can map that area that you've defined back to a field. It's really cool stuff. Like, I really like this. And I've never seen anything like this before. And this is why I'm so passionate about sharing it with you all, because I honestly think this is amazing that we could do this today. So let's just give this a few minutes so that it can go and grab the five documents that I've uploaded.
And Eliza, is this something that you have to do on a regular basis to do this analysis, or it's only once?
It's only once, but so you can still go back, and I'm pretty sure you could still create additional collections if you want. But what I will show you when we have trained this model is you can also perform tests after it's been trained as well, which again is pretty cool.
So to kind of loop back on the best practices, so we're talking here about five documents. That's like the minimal. Have you seen better results at a certain number of documents, or?
Yes. So when I tested this out last year in May, so that was when it was version 1, I tested it out with 30 documents, but not with a revenue kickback form. I tested it with a New Zealand form, and I tested it with both. In terms of what I mean by both, as in where it was either entered digitally like this, or if it was handwritten. And yeah, it works whether it's handwritten or filled in digitally through a PDF application. Nice. So yeah, it's pretty good. It's pretty powerful in my opinion. Okay, so I'm just going to zoom in just so that you can see on your end. Okay, so I'll just explain the layout of the screen. So in the middle is essentially the form that you've uploaded as part of those five documents in that collection. And then over on the right hand side is the fields that you created in step 2. So these are the fields that we've defined that we want to essentially map the data from the document against. And then up here is where you will see a list of, the documents that you need to pretty much tag so that the model can be trained. So at minimum, it does need five documents for each collection. So another best practice tip from me is that if you are using forms, and in this particular revenue kickback form, there's a whole bunch of fields, have at least one form that has all of the data provided. So for example, in this one, you could see that all of these rows are filled out. Whereas if I jump to this second document, you can see that not all of the rows are filled out. And the reason why I say provide at least one form that has all of the fields of the information that you need is so that it knows what it needs to look for in the scenario where every single information is provided in the form. So that's another best practice tip from me. Okay, so in terms of the highlighting and dragging and then mapping it to a field, it's pretty easy. So if I go and highlight this field, so if I go monthly income, so I'm just using my mouse, as you can see, and it's grabbed those values automatically. I can now map it to my field that I've defined, and then you'll see that it has recognized it, and it knows that for this particular area in the document, it's going to be mapped to a monthly income field. That's pretty cool, right? I mean, come on. where have you seen this, you know, elsewhere outside of the Microsoft ecosystem? So again, just to demonstrate, I am simply using my mouse. I am using my mouse cursor to drag and highlight and tag the information in the document, and I select fuel and oil. So you pretty much go through that. And if you also don't want to drag and drop, it also has a smart, so let me just zoom in so you can see this a bit better, where it will actually automatically detect that data. So you see how if I just move my mouse cursor now over the 325 value, it already highlights the area that it detects information from. So now if I just click on this, so this time I have it dragged and dragged across the information, it's just correctly picked it up. So this one is vehicle expenses. And then if we then scroll down and have a look on the right, you can see it in there as well. So pretty much what you do is you go and highlight every single information that you need and map it to the field. And then you have to repeat it across the documents. So once again, I'm going to move to another AI Builder model where I've already done that. Otherwise, we'll be here for a long time. So in this AI Builder model, I've gone and selected all of the fields across my five documents. So then now we're ready to train this model. And we can then go ahead and use it. Oh, sorry. One thing that I forgot to mention is, so let's say, pretend in this form that this field isn't populated. You can pretty much just find it. So delivery freight and messenger services. And then you can click on not available in document, and then it won't be ticked. Otherwise, if you don't define each of the fields, it's not going to let you move on to the next document. So you have to define each of the fields, so whether it does exist or it doesn't exist in the form. And if it also doesn't exist in the collection, you also have that option to select that as well. Okay, so then once you have tagged all of your forms, so in here you can see that I've tagged all of it and it's showing a tick because I've gone through all of the fields. So as I mentioned, if you don't map all of the fields, whether they exist or not on the form, it's not going to allow you to progress in the AI Builder training. So basically, if you don't see this tick, then you can't continue. All right. So now that I've done all of that, the last thing that you're going to be presented is a summary. So it's going to tell you the model type of AI Builder. So it's form processing. It's going to tell you how many collections you have. So in this scenario, I only have one. It's going to tell you where these documents have come from. So it's from my local storage. And then it's also going to show you all of the fields that you've defined and that you've mapped to the documents that have been uploaded. So then the very last thing that you need to do is click on train. And in here, it's going to give you this pop-up and it's going to tell you that it's in the process of training. So now when you click on go to models, it'll then show you all of your models that you created to date, whether there is still a draft, if they're published, or if they're in training. So right now it's showing it's in training. And when it's finished training, it's going to be updated to published, and then you'll be able to perform a test on it. So because that one's training, I'm going to show you this one that the app is actually using. So then, remember earlier I said you can perform a test as well once the model has been trained. You click on quick test, and then again, you can upload a document. So let's say I want to test with this Quebec form. And in here, it's going to analyze the data from the form. And again, it'll show you the data that is detected based on the tagging and the fields that you've defined. And if I hover over one of them, it's going to show me the data that is detected, and it's also going to tell you a confidence score. So a confidence score means this is how accurate the AI Builder model has detected that data. And so again, if we try another field, such as title tax advisor, it's showing 99%. Okay, so I'll just close this, and then we'll go back to my list of models. Okay, so now we can see that it's moved from training to trained. So now when I open it up, it's gonna display a button where you can click on publish. So this is gonna publish the AI Builder model. So I'm gonna click that. And right now it's in the process of publishing. And once it's published, then your AI Builder model is pretty much good to go. So the next couple of things that I'm going to show you is the automation. So the Cloudflow that performs the trigger, the one that will be triggered when an email is sent to a particular email address. So I'll show you how you can configure that. And then I'll show you what the app looks like from the point of view of a process owner and a manual reviewer. Okay. So in terms of the first flow, it is this one, the document automation email importer. For me, when I went through this, this is the only flow that I've had to configure. But if you want to extend the cloud flows, you also have the ability to do that as well. Because as I mentioned, this is a starting point for you to understand how this document automation toolkit works. And once you get an idea of how it works, you can then modify it to how you need it to work in your organization. So in terms of the trigger, what I've modified in here is I've said that the subject needs to contain this value. Otherwise, if another email comes through to this particular inbox, then it's not gonna trigger, basically. So that's how that's gonna work. And then in terms of the app that the reviewer sees, the process owner. So in this example, I've given this user both the system customizer and the document automation reviewer security role. So in here, they're seeing what they would see if they were a manual reviewer and a process owner. So this configuration tab is where it's going to show you the AI Builder model that it's linked to. If you didn't have one, then there'll be a button here that says, I think it said add. So if you click on it, it's going to prompt you to select which model you want. And in this table, you're only ever going to see your AI Builder form processing model that has been published. If it is in draft or if it's in the status of trained, you're not going to see in here. So keep that in mind. And then when you click on next, it's going to show you all of the fields that have been defined and which column it maps to in the Dataverse table of document automation data. So remember how I said earlier, your data is stored in Dataverse. So then after you validate it, if you want to lift that data up and push it to another application or system within your organization, this would be the table that you grab the details from. Okay, so let's go ahead and see this all in action. So pretend I'm someone from the outside and I've sent this person an email. This person now goes, hey, we've received a document from this particular customer. So I'm going to send it to that inbox that's been defined in the Cloudflow. And we're going to go ahead and see this all in action. So I've received a form from one of our customers. Regards, Christy. So I'll select one of the documents. So this time I'll use Dominique and I'll hit send. So now what's happening is that Outlook inbox will eventually receive the email, which is in here. So this is the email that I've sent as Christy. And because I've put that value in the subject that the flow is going to look for, it's now going to be triggered. So I'm going to click the back button and we can see that it has triggered my Cloudflow. And then the next Cloudflow that's going to run in the chain of automation is this one, the document automation processor. So now if I hit refresh, we should see it come through. So it does take just a little bit of time for it to kick off. So we'll just give it a few seconds. Cool. So here it is. So now this flow has been triggered because the status has been updated to, I think it's extracting data. So now it's going to go ahead and go through each of the fields that have been defined based on the AI Builder model. And then based on the tagging, it's then going to find that particular area in the form, grab that data, and insert it in the document automation data dataverse table. So we'll just wait for it to succeed, which it has. And then the final flow is the document automation validator table. Cloudflow. So then this is where it's going to update the status to ready to be reviewed. So now if I go back to my app, and we click on the Documents tab, and at the moment it's just refreshing. We can see that the form for Dominique has come through and its status is now manual review. So as a manual reviewer, I can now come in here. I can view this document that has been analyzed where the data has automatically been extracted from the AI Builder model. And we can see that it's showing up side by side with the form and then the fields in terms of the data that's been extracted from the form. So it's a really nice visualization for someone to come in and be able to look at the data side by side. If there's any blank fields, it will display in red, and that's to prompt you as a reviewer to make sure that for direct expenses, which is this line item in the form, there's definitely a blank field. Ooh, here we go. So that field isn't populated, and so that's why we're seeing blank. Now, if you look closely, you'll see that the social insurance number has picked up an additional character of pipe, and that's because it picked it up from the lines that show up in this Revenue Quebec form. And because there's also some spacing, it's also put in some spaces as well as picked up some commas. So the nice thing about this app is that the person who's reviewing the document can actually go and edit the data in the field. So in here, I've just clicked into the field. I'm deleting the commas, I'm deleting the spaces, I'm deleting the pipe character. And then once I'm done, that's pretty much it. So I've just tidied it up. If there's other things that I need to update, so I don't know, let's say if you want to get rid of the comma, you can do that as well. And then you can click on validate. So then what's going to happen is it's going to update the status from ready to be reviewed to validated. And that's pretty much it in terms of the document automation toolkit. So just as a recap, I've shown you how to create your new environment, install the solution, as well as set up your connectors by authenticating as yourself. And then the next thing that we did was go through the security roles that you needed to assign to the users, as well as the important detail of sharing this app with your manual reviewers or your process owners. And then I showed you how to create your AI Builder form processing model in the Power Automate Maker site. And then we talked about how you can configure your Cloudflow trigger to point it to a particular inbox, and then how you can configure the app to use that particular AI Builder model. So you go into the configuration tab and then showing it all to you in action. So I'm gonna head back to my slides and we're gonna go through the rest of them in here. So we've gone through this. Okay, so in terms of the ideas to extend the automation, because essentially, again, like I mentioned, this is how the toolkit works out of the box. And in this particular business use case where you're grabbing the data from a revenue Quebec form, obviously that data needs to go somewhere. So then you can have some logic as well, where if the contact already exists using the social insurance number, because that is a field that we can use to uniquely identify that person in the system, then you can have some logic where if they do exist, then simply just create a new self-employed net income record that's going to have all of that information. Otherwise, if they don't exist, then create a new contact and then create that secondary record of the self-employed net income record. What I do want to highlight, though, is if you paid attention and look closely to my app, so if I just go back to the app, I just remembered I forgot to put this in a slide, you'll see that it just stops at the social insurance number. But when we have a look at a list of my fields, we still have another 7 fields that are not in the app. And that's because at the moment it can only pick up to 27 fields. However, I've been working with the team and they've told me that it is possible to update the logic so that it can go beyond the 27 fields. So once I've figured that out, I will be doing a WTF episode on my YouTube channel. So make sure you do follow me, because if you are thinking about implementing this in your own organization and you're definitely going to have more than 27 fields in a form, then yeah, keep your eyes peeled for my episode that's going to be coming out maybe sometime next month. Okay, so in terms of languages, there are, why is this not showing full screen? Well, that's okay. It does support a number of languages. I know Quebec has their own form of, or different style of French. It's not like the French that's based in France. But there are multiple languages that are supported. In terms of learning this yourself, self-learning, there is a Microsoft Learn module. So if you have your mobile phone, just go ahead and scan this QR code right now, and it will take you to this module. So it's gonna go through the steps step by step in terms of how you install it. It won't go into the exact same detail as I did, but it's good enough for you to understand and work out how you need to get going yourself in your own organization. So it's a good module to learn from. And then in terms of what's coming with AI Builder, this is essentially the way to plan release notes. And one of the things that has been outlined in here is that there will be support for checkboxes coming. So at the moment, it's not supported from what I've shown you, but it is coming. So again, keep your eyes peeled in terms of when that particular feature will be released. But as you can see, the product team are working hard and are committed to making this a really first-class tool for companies around the world to use. Okay, so then now I'm going to open up to Q&A. I'm just going to check the chat and see what questions have been asked. Oh, wow, there's a lot of questions.
I've tried to answer some of them as we went along. I would say one interesting one from Joon Wang is about if an email contains multiple documents,
yes,
and let's say only one of the attachment, you know, fits the model, and I think Clelio add like something relative in the same line where, for example, if a document doesn't fit the model, like how does it react right now?
Oh, I haven't tried that, but normally what best practice is when you're working with Pair Automate is you have error handling built in. So what I mean by error handling is, so for anyone who's a code first developer that's in our call right now, you would know what I'm referring to. So essentially in Pair Automate, you can have this thing called scope. So a scope is essentially where you can group your actions in your Cloud Flow. And so typically what we would do is that you would have, it's try, catch, finally. So you'd have three scopes. So in the first scope is try. So that's where you would have a majority of your actions that essentially are the core of your automation. So then in the next scope, which is the catch, that would be essentially what would happen if your try scope fails. So in your catch scope, would be when your try scope has failed. And in there is when you would have, let's say an email or a Teams message action that will alert someone that this Cloud Flow has failed. And then in your final scope, which is called finally, that's where you can do some additional logic of what should happen, whether it should be marked as succeeded or failed. So in the scenario where it does fail, then your catch scope would be triggered, and then it would go and send the necessary alerts or notifications to the relevant people. So then they can be like, oh, hey, something has gone wrong. We need to go and look into this Cloud Flow. And you would design that catch in a way where it has the hyperlink to that Cloud Flow run history, so that anyone who gets that notification or that alert can just click on the hyperlink and it'll take them straight to the run history. And then they'll be able to see, oh, this form that has been attached to the email doesn't match any of the layouts that has been defined in this AI builder model. So that's a really good question. So thank you for asking that. Okay, are there any other notable ones?
Yeah, there were some about handwriting, and I answered that part. Other ones, like I have Sarah, who had a few questions. Maybe you can jump in, Sarah. You have a mic and camera available.
Thank you. I have to choose among all my questions. Thank you for such an interesting content.
Yeah.
Well, I have one question. It's maybe a high level one, but
okay.
The example you used is a pretty common form, right? It's a government form. So we could assume that this collection could be used in other contexts, for other projects, other companies. So is there any way or any advantage of using a collection in another context to export it and use it in another tenant?
Oh, right.
Models can be exported by or handled via solutions. So that might be one path to explore. But it's not being able to reuse the collection itself. So it's more like the model that was generated out of it.
I'm just writing this down so I can ask the relevant team. And Sarah, did you have another question as well?
Well, I'm trying to figure out. Oh, sorry. I just saw my hair. Oh, that's embarrassing. So I was saying, so you outline like a zone for your field.
Oh yeah, the tagging. Yeah. Okay, so let's go back.
So how sensitive is it? So let's say that we have like a printed out document and we scan it crooked for whatever reason. How would it catch it? Is it very sensitive to the zone, or it would catch the actual field?
It would still work. So let me see if I can bring this AI Builder July update. So Cedric has actually provided a blog post, and he actually talks about that. So you see this? You see how it's all crooked and a bit wonky? It'll still work. So it's got the smarts in there for it. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
I'll put it in the chat as well.
Yes.
Okay, what else? What other questions do you have? Throw them at me. I want to hear them.
I had a question from Clivia, and it's quite interesting because, you know, in there is, you know, the Microsoft marketing and the, you know, what the product team blogs out about, and there is the actual experience that, you know, as I've experienced, you have experience in implementing these, or, you know, at least working with these models. Like, what have you come out as, you know, there is the bells and whistles, but here's where, you know, you need to focus in terms of what needs to be, you know, where we need to be, take caution, let's say.
Yeah. So what I would advise, and I did this in a presentation last year, so let me see if I can find it in this one. Just give me one second. If I can't find it, let me go back and perform a test so I can show you what I'm referring to. So for every field that it detects, it will give a confidence score. And one thing that you're not going to read or see from the actual presentations that are done by the team or from Microsoft is talking about the confidence score. So in the scenario where you have, let's say, a confidence score that's below 50, well, someone needs to look into that, right? So you need to make sure that you have that logic in your Cloudflow, again, where it's going to alert or notify someone that the confidence score for this particular field, for this particular form, is not that great. So someone needs to check it out. There is a feature coming. I don't know if it's in this one. Oh yeah, it is. So let me just scroll in, where in the app, you'll see that they're going to display the confidence score in there. So eventually in the app, you will be able to see it. But what I just demoed to you today, you don't see it. So that is something that you do need to be aware of. And that confidence score can be extracted from one of the properties in the AI Builder action. I just can't remember which one it is, but it's definitely there. So that's again, another piece of advice for me is don't necessarily rely completely on the data that it picks up. One thing that you can use is look at the confidence score just to make sure that the data is accurate. And then eventually this app will provide you with the visibility of the score. But yeah, right now it doesn't.
But let's say you have like consistently a low confidence score. What can you do to address that?
Oh, that's a good point. I guess maybe continue training it, or I wonder why it would be
you'll need a larger set
as a
of
low
documents.
Score. Yeah. I mean, the only thing that I can think of that would possibly impact the confidence score is when it's handwritten. And because I have noticed that in the forms where I've digitally filled it in using, let's say, Adobe Sign, it does pick it up. But if it's handwritten, of course, then the confidence can vary because, as Eric said, for it to understand different types of handwriting, you need to feed it different forms, basically. So if you're an organization right now that does both, then my advice would be to grab any of those different sets of forms and then train your model and test it and see how it's going to handle it. Yeah. Because handwritten is still one of those things where it's an unknown until you actually see it in action. Whereas if it's filled in digitally, then of course it's not going to be that much of an issue. Yeah. Other questions? Oh, sorry. One more tip that I do have, and again, it's not I didn't go through this in this webinar, but I have another webinar, I can find it later on and share it in the chat, is when you're dealing with dates. So for example, this is like a shorthand date. You've got the month, you've got the date, and you've got the year. But when you are working with particular systems, so let's say you're working with Workday or SAP that you need to move this data to, hang on, let me see if I can bring up my notepad for it. Every system has a particular date format. So here we go. So let me just zoom in so you can all see this. So this is UTC. So if you are picking, if you're grabbing a date value and you're going to be pushing it to a different application, you need to make sure that the date value is in this format, which is what all systems use in terms of UTC. If you don't have it in this format, then the other application or the other system, it's probably going to throw an error because it's going to be like, I don't understand what you're sending me. I don't understand what this is. I need to have it in this format. So you can tidy up your dates as well. Let me see if I can share that that link to my other webinar just so that you guys can have a look and see whether that'll work. Actually, I know it does work because I've tested it myself.
I guess it's sort of one of the attendees' question, Graham, who was talking about the social security number or things like that, where we might want to remove like the unwanted characters. There also, it's a matter of, I guess, adapting the flow to put that special logic of replacing, searching and replacing, unwanted characters.
So this recording is going to cover exactly what Eric has explained in there. So in this recording, I show how to remove, characters or spaces, as well as how to handle the date time format. So this is when it was version one. So keep in mind that when you are watching this video, when it comes to the defining the fields and the tagging, it might look a bit different, but the fundamental concept there in terms of how you tidy up your fields is in that particular webinar recording.
Good stuff.
So Juhun said, oh, he agrees. Juhun, I think you're Korean, so I'm going to say, Annyeonghaseyo. I said that right. Hello, thank you so much for joining us today, by the way. And yeah, do we have any other questions that I can answer?
I think it wraps it up. Thank you so much, Elisa. It was a great session, very much appreciated, and right on timing based on the projects we currently have on top of that. So.
Yeah, no problem. And again, if anyone else has questions, feel free to reach out to Exa and Vision. They'll be able to help out. Otherwise, merci beaucoup.